Good morning. Let's begin this morning's service singing praises to our Lord. Please stand if you are able.
You. Help us to hear your word and obey it, and bring your saving love to fruition in our lives. Through Jesus Christ, our Savior and Lord, who lives and reigns with you in the Holy Spirit, one God, now and forever. Amen. You may be seated. I want to welcome you today to Bayview Lutheran Church as we are in the third Sunday of Lent. Hopefully, as you came in on the screen, you saw our many announcements that we had. However, I want to highlight a few of them for you. With us being in the season of Lent, we are in a walking challenge. We are trying to walk 1 mile a day, and then each day of that, give $1 for a total of $40 that will go to help fight ELCA world hunger. Another aspect as a church that we are trying to do is spotlight our wonderful volunteers that make the church happen. And so if you have an individual that you think that we as a church should highlight, I want to encourage you to pass that name on to myself. We are in the season of Lent, which means we are going to be coming into the Easter season, and we are asking individuals who would be willing to help us decorate the altar for Easter. There are sheets that are in the fellowship hall for flowers, so if you would like to donate a flower, please fill out a sheet. The final announcement that I want to give to you today is as you exit the church and in the fellowship hall, outside of the fellowship hall, you will see a donation box. The donation box is for both Lutheran World Relief for Ukraine and also United Way for Butch's Bar. And there's art on the table that you can pick up for a donation as well. So think about serving by giving to those outside of the church. Let us take a moment and pause as we get ready to enter into our confession and assurance. In the name of God, who makes a way in the wilderness, walks with us and guides us in our pilgrimage. Let us rest in a moment of silence for personal reflection before we confess one together. Holy One, we confess that we have wandered far from you. We have not trusted your promises. We have ignored your prophets in our own day. We have squandered our inheritance of grace. We have failed to recognize you in our midst. Have mercy on us. Forgive us and turn us again to you. Teach us to follow in your ways. Assure us again of your love. And help us to love our neighbor. Amen. Beloved in Christ, the world draws near to you. And all who call out to God shall be saved. In Jesus, God comes to you again and again and gathers you under the wings of love. In Jesus' name, your sins are forgiven. God's journey with you and teaches you how to live in love. Thank you.
First reading today is from Isaiah. Ho, everyone who thirsts, come to the waters. And you that have no money, come, buy and eat. Come, buy wine and milk without money and without price. Why do you spend your money for that which is not bread, and your labor for that which does not satisfy? Listen carefully to me, and eat what is good, and delight yourselves in rich food. Incline your ear and come to me. Listen, so that you may live. I will make with you an everlasting covenant, my steadfast, sure love for David. See, I made him a witness to the peoples, a leader and commander for the peoples. See, you shall call nations that you do not know, and nations that do not know you shall run to you because of the Lord your God, the Holy One of Israel, for he has glorified you. Seek the Lord while he may be found. Call upon him while he is near. Let the wicked forsake their way and the unrighteous their thoughts. Let them return to the Lord, that he may have mercy on them, and to our God, for he will abundantly pardon. For my thoughts are not your thoughts, nor are your ways my ways, says the Lord. For as the heavens are higher than the earth, so are my ways higher than your ways, and my thoughts than your thoughts. The word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
Our psalm reading that we'll be reading responsibly today comes from Psalm 63, verses 1 through 8. I will read the odd verses and I'll ask you as a congregation to respond with the even verses. O God, you are my God. Eagerly I seek you. My soul thirsts for you. My flesh faints for you, as in a dry and weary land, where there is no water.
Therefore I am gazed upon you in your holy place, and I might behold your power and your glory.
For your steadfast love is better than life itself. My lips shall give you praise.
So will I bless you as long as I live, and lift up my hands in your name.
My spirit is content, as with the riches of food, and my mouth praises you with joyful lips.
When I remember you upon my bed, and meditate on you in the night watches.
For you have been my hope, and under the shadow of your wings I will rejoice.
My whole being clings to you, your right hand holds me fast.
Our second reading is from 1 Corinthians. I do not want you to be unaware, brothers and sisters, that our ancestors were all under the cloud, and all passed through the sea, and all were baptized into Moses in the cloud and in the sea, and all ate the same spiritual food, and all drank the same spiritual drink. For they drank from the spiritual rock that followed them, and the rock was Christ. Nevertheless, God was not pleased with most of them, and they were struck down in the wilderness. Now these things occurred as examples for us, so that we might not desire evil as they did. Do not become idolaters as some of them did. As it is written, the people sat down to eat and drink, and they rose up to play. We must not indulge in sexual immorality as some of them did, and 23,000 fell in a single day. We must not put Christ to the test as some of them did, and were destroyed by serpents. And do not complain as some of them did, and were destroyed by the destroyer. These things happened to them to serve as an example, and they were written down to instruct us on whom the ends of the ages have come. So if you think you are standing, watch out that you do not fall. No testing has overtaken you that is not common to everyone. God is faithful, and he will not let you be tested beyond your strength. But with the testing, he will also provide the way out, so that you may be able to endure it. The word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
May you rise for the gospel reading. The Holy Gospel according to Luke.
Glory to you, Lord.
At that very time, there were some present who told him about the Galileans whose blood Pilate had mingled with their sacrifice. children up for the children's message.
Help us out. church are afraid to speak on these issues. But it comes directly from the text. And many of us may not even realize what Jesus is referencing. Thus, let me share with you. I will warn you, it is not pretty. Pilate was a violent man. Pilate executed numerous Galileans. They were headed to Jerusalem to make a religious sacrifice. Pilate had a strong habit of brutality. So as the Galileans are making their spiritual trek, he murders them. And then he decides to mix their blood with the blood that is coming from the sacrifices that they are making. So we may want to pause and think about that. Think about what Jesus is saying in light of what we know, what we will be reading and reflecting on in a few weeks with Jesus' own interaction with Pilate. The second event was a natural disaster. The natural act of disaster that occurred was a tower collapsed that was built into the wall that surrounded the city of Jerusalem. This accident caused the death of 18 individuals. The accident came without warning, and the loss of life came unexpectedly. Since I was not around in the first century, I can only speculate. But I imagine that the community who gathered at the local watering hole was discussing these two tragedies at length. Thus, Jesus seizes on these two calamities and decides to speak on them. However, his focus is not to dwell long on the state-sanctioned terror or the random accident that caused death. There is a good chance that those who were listening in had individuals in their lives that was connected to one of those events. However, both of those events probably drove people to realize how fast that their lives could collapse. Jesus shares with them a hard and honest truth. Life can change in an instant. And unfortunately, life can be nasty, it can be harsh, and all too often, it can be short. It is intriguing that Jesus also does not use this as an opportunity to defend God. Once again, I was not there, and it's not in the text, but I am sure that there were individuals in the crowd that shared the following sentiment. Where was God? If there was a God, individuals would have not been killed while going to worship. If God really cared, he would not have had the tower collapse. Or at least, he could have spared their lives. What Jesus does, though, is the following. He makes sure that they know and that we know that sin does not make atrocities occur. They come. Now please understand, you will hear that though. There are pastors, there are churches that preach bad things occur because people are not following God's way. In his teaching though, Jesus uses these two stories as a backdrop. The backdrop comes in this form: life's fragility gives it urgency. Maybe the crowd would have wished that Jesus would have spent time conversing on the disaster, the victims, or answering the why question. But that is not where he landed. Instead, Jesus lands on repentance, which might surprise us. I believe that he is wanting the hearers to turn to God and not focus in on their false self-assurances. I know that this can be a very tough subject to approach. But many times, I feel that Christians, they mistake our good fortunes as evidence of God's blessing. So, in his teaching, where he speaks on the fact of life's fragility, demands urgency, this is to show us that life itself can carve out an opportunity for us to see God's graciousness. And this is what puts us at the footstep of the fig tree parable. In this short parable, Jesus might be channeling John the Baptizer. Remember when John talked about the axe at the foot of the tree, and that the tree who does not produce fruit needs to be cut down, thrown into the fire? It seems that at least for a time, a cultivated yet unproductive tree may continue to live, even when it does not produce fruit. It does not seem that it would happen for long that a swift and just destruction will occur. I want to try to avoid using this parable as an analogy. Instead, I think that we can simply say that this parable shows patience and mercy, even if only temporary. Because of the garden, we see that everything possible is going to be done so the tree can act as it should, producing a crop. I think that we can glean from this is that God does not leave us on our own. We have no idea about the outcome. We are left hanging in this story. So here is part of my story. Many times, we do see individuals. They are nudged to change when a tragedy occurs, or when an individual encounters hardship. However, once again, as we see in these two stories, a tragedy can mark the end and not the beginning, thus not giving us an opportunity to live lives inclined towards God after a tragedy. So those are not joyful words, right? I mean, words of judgment and repentance, they can be frightening. But they reveal to us what life is really about. Life is definitely a gift, but it's a fragile one. The good news, though, is that we can lean into the fact that repentance has an arc that leads towards joy. As mentioned in the announcement, out in the gathering space, we have art and a donation box. The donations that are being collected are for two recent tragedies. Locally, which far from a world perspective, the Ukraine relief effort, and it can shine light once again on what happens when a leader uses power for evil and brutality. I want to encourage you to support the causes. I wish that I could point to those two instances and explain the causes away easily. However, in our text today, Jesus does not do that. Thus, I really cannot lean into the how and the why. What I can do is point in a way that Jesus pointed and ask you a very pointed question. How will you live the life you get to live? I think that the tragedy of the text and the tragedies that we see and face in our country and world drives us to a time of mourning and lamenting. And those are good, and they allow us to discuss and to support one another. When I look back over my 50 years of life, there are many mile markers in my life that have shaken me. They have brought me out of my comfort zone. In our Bible study, the phrase that was used was the following. Life has the tendency to shake us out of our complacency. Then, on the flip side of the coin, many times when bad things happen, we also try to put a wall up. We want to keep a distance between us and the event. We want to protect ourselves. And in an attempt to protect ourselves, we do so in ways that are truly done with a false assurance. As I was looking at our baptismal promise, hear the word of God and share in the Lord's Supper. back in my mind. Individuals in our Bible study are hoping and praying that more people will come back to Bayview and fill up these pews. Or people will come to Bayview for the first time. We may want to see this quickly, but it may take time, and it might mean that we need a little bit more patience, just like the gardener. We may all want to listen in to the conversation that the gardener had with the owner. In essence, this is what the gardener said. What we have been doing has not worked. Let us try something different. May we, as individuals and as a church, be open to the Spirit moving. And may we be willing to take some risks, try something new, and maybe we will see some unexpected fruit. May we allow the God of the universe to transform us through grace. And with this grace, may we reach out and be gracious to those who need an extra cup of grace and love. I ask you to rise for the hymn of the day, Shout to the Lord.
the Holy Catholic Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and the life everlasting.
Accept the prayers we bring, O God, on behalf of a world
Now we gather at your feast, where you offer us the food that satisfies. Take and use what we offer here. Come among us and feed us with the body and blood of Christ, in whose name we pray. Amen. The Lord be with you.
And also with you.
Lift up your hearts. Let us give thanks to the Lord our God.
It is right to give our thanks and praise.
In the night in which he was betrayed, our Lord Jesus, he took bread. He gave thanks, and he broke it. And he gave it to his disciples, saying, "Take and eat. This is my body given for you. Do this in the remembrance of me." Then again, after supper, he took the cup. Gave thanks, and he gave it to all to drink, saying, "This cup is the new covenant in my blood, shed for you and for all people for the forgiveness of sin. Do this in the remembrance of me." Lord, remember us in your kingdom and teach us to pray. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the